child has been born for us, the son is given, authority rests upon his shoulders. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I think all of us give thanks for this kind of government. In a nation that has been rocked by an election, and where we find ourselves still very much a divided nation, the concept of messianic government is really good news. In this age, or in, for that matter, in any age, where human beings are in control, we find that somehow there is not quite enough control for our taste. We have problems, and we need someone to bear them. What has become very clear to me is that we fallible human beings simply do not have enough insight to see every possible problem and meet it with an appropriate solution. I think that we think sometimes that things will miraculously change when we elect some new leader, but often they give us old problems in a new way. This past week, we need only to consult our newspapers or our online journals, and we find a bombing in Berlin, shots fired at a U.S. embassy in Turkey, wildfires in Oklahoma, evacuation of citizens in Aleppo. Things change, but the headlines might as well read the same way as they did in Luke's gospel. Tyrannus elected governor of Syria. Census demanded by Caesar. Every citizen must report. Our leaders do the best they can, but really are powerless to have the kind of vision, the kind of scope to get things done. The world is a violent place, just like it has always been. We still have wars. We still have rumors of wars. And bright minds from all over the place suggest things. Take, for example, the League of Nations, or then the United Nations, or NATO, or the European Union, or even the Peace Corps. But we still have the same issues. It's too big for us. I've observed, and many others have, that we are returning to a world where there's no middle class. We're becoming a society of haves and have-nots. The unsustainable levels, for example, of student loan debt place us at the dawn of a national crisis. Day in and day out, government quibbles as to the reality of things like climate change. And still, to all these things, the world awaits answers that don't come. And they certainly don't come quick enough for us. Quite frankly, our leaders, not a single one of them, has the vision to sort out these sorts of problems. And so this night, it should come to us a little bit of relief that God and God alone knows what he's doing. And it is to the ills of human government and the perils of human nature that we read the solution to all of it. And we find it in the words of the prophet Isaiah. And he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there will be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and righteousness from this time forward and forevermore. And so for all those things that we read this previous week in our newspaper, we read a sigh of relief and we know God ultimately is in control. Let's breathe it together. God is in control. Then we turn to the Gospels and we are opened to a mystery. And this mysterious plan unfolds not with a massive election, or with an upheaval, or with a coup, but with a child. It's a surprise that's been hinted at over and over in the Old Covenant. But it's fair to say that most of them didn't see that there. They were too focused, as we often are, in the might and power. To be clear, God didn't somehow change his mind. He didn't say, I'm going to try something new because the old order didn't work. He knew from everlasting what would happen. But he also knew that the typical power structures and conquests don't really work when we're trying to win over the hearts of people. In fact, God's power is made perfect in human frailty, in vulnerability, and that the grace sufficient for each and every one of us is actually made perfect in weakness. The kingdom of weakness that conquers all the strong. That seems counterintuitive, but that's God's way of doing business. In our gospel reading for today, we come face to face with two different kinds of power. In the first few verses, we're confronted with big government, the scope of the Pax Romana. We read, in those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus, all the world should be registered. And then we get to find out who's in power. And each one goes to their own town to be registered. Joseph takes Mary. They do what the rest of the Roman Empire was doing. Caesar Augustus at that time, a man considered by his pagan subjects to be divine, sits on his throne in Rome, pontificates an order, and Europe, North Africa, and the Near East acquiesces to this rather ridiculous and very costly census. So people put their lives on hold while Rome decides one more thing that's going to cost them money. Now, to be clear, the Caesars were the most powerful rulers that were known in the ancient world. Like many other despotic rulers, they claimed some pretty awesome titles for themselves. Interestingly enough, the same titles that we ascribe to Jesus. In contrast to that supreme power of Rome comes the story of a humble carpenter, or stonecutter, as some would have it, who has a dream and is revealed that these very titles that the Roman dictator claims for himself, God is going to place on the child. Child that the fiancé is great with and soon will go into labor. Out of weakness comes strength, and a Lord and a Savior, the same titles reserved for Caesar, are given to a little child. So on one hand, we have the enormous power of imperial Rome and of every earthly government. And on the other hand, we have a child that's born away from home, who spent most of his life in relative obscurity, and then spends 3 years of an earthly ministry teaching and healing before Rome, again, decides he's just too much of a threat. Isaiah may have said that authority rests upon your shoulders, but the authority would be built through humility. Not through scepter and crown, but two timbers and three nails. Execution day is tantamount here to coronation day. Now the Roman Empire is long gone, but oddly the movement that Jesus started is still here, and we're evidence of that tonight. The earlier followers of the way had no budget, they had no strategic plan, they had no buildings, they had no social media, and yet it is this very subtle kingdom that still is pulling the strings in human history. So Luke's story introduces us to a new form of government. Jesus isn't another politician, promising much and delivering nothing. He isn't riding in on messianic overtones. He is exactly who he claims to be. And his way of establishing peace and justice on earth was and is totally counterintuitive to all the dirty tricks of Rome or Washington or any other place. And today, we need that hope just as much now as they did in the first century. So how do you go about changing the world? Well, it's usually not by being elected or seizing control of government. Brute force isn't really appealing, however well-intentioned it may be. True change, true transformation, comes from here, from inside out, the way God intended it. You change the lives of ordinary people, like shepherds, and construction workers, and peasants, by loving them into the kingdom. Change comes in one who washes feet, as opposed to one who demands that his feet be washed. The world never really reacted well to this kind of hostile takeover of the world, but it did react well to the unhostile takeover of Jesus in the manger. It's not the standard power grab, but it is the unconventional way that you see results that stand the test of time. So if you want government that's based on goodness, it cannot have corruption as its foundation. And as of yet, I have failed to see a successful leader who got that part right. So this night, as we remember the birth of the king, let's embrace monarchy. Real monarchy. Loving monarchy. Our ministries, our simple ways in which we love like Jesus, are the most potent force to change the world. So let's tonight endeavor to leave this house of worship and go do unconventional and yet government-altering acts of changing the world one life at a time. We love the one agency of grace that transforms each and every one of us, the very thing that brought you here tonight, and the very thing that is the hope for the nations yet to come. And we do so in the name of Jesus, who is Savior. Thank you.